Good evening and good morning for those who are in Australia. This is Professor Marília Morosini, and on behalf of the Center of Internationalization Brazil-Australia, School of Humanity, I would like to greet the speakers and participants present at this webinar. It's so important to point out that the new partnership between PUCI and the Australia Embassy will allow the establishment of a solid network of knowledge, unique in Latin America, in the Global South, with a direct impact on the quality of teacher education of students and researchers. I would like to thank our guest speakers, Dr. Craig Whitsett and Dr. Luciane Slavieri. You also would like to thank the members from the Embassy of Australia in Brazil, our Vice President, the General Representative of the United States at Brazil, our institutional partners, associations, colleagues from other universities, dedicated professionals, professors, researchers, students, and everyone else who is here with us. Before we start the meeting, I would like to ask everyone to do their interaction through chat. And at the end, we will have a space for our guests to discuss the issues presented here. In our first webinar, we will have a discussion on seeks to develop the didactic pedagogical part of internationalization, with a focus on methodology, development, and evaluation of learning results, teacher and the student's qualification. It's based on the experience and practices that have been developed in the country. And you have as guests, Professor Craig Whitsett from Curtin University, Australia, and Professor Luciane Stavlieri from Federal University of Santa Catarina. To start our meeting, we will introduce Professor Craig. Dr. Craig is senior lecturer at Curtin University School of Education, Faculty of Humanities. He is lead for the research group Education and Pedagogy within the School of Education course coordinator for the postgraduate certificate, Higher Education, Innovative Learning and Teaching. Craig is a member of the International Education Association of Australia Research Committee and the past convener of the Special Interest Group for Internationalizing the Curriculum. Craig is fellow at the Center for Internationalization of Education at the University of Groningen, Netherlands, and visiting scholar 2019 at the Center for International Higher Education at Lynch School of Education and Human Development at Boston College. Craig is a senior fellow of the Murdoch University Learning Excellence Academy, where he worked in academy professional development. I invite Professor Craig for start his speech.
Good evening, everyone. And thank you for the great privilege to be able to join you today and participate in this first of the thematic webinars organised by the Centre. I think it's such a fantastic initiative. I've only got 15 minutes, so I'm going to really move very quickly through the first series of slides, and then I'll move into the last two slides, which really talk to the teaching and learning dynamic. There's a lot of information on these slides. I'm not going to speak to all of the information on these slides. You can come back to them if you wish and read that information. The focus of my conversation this morning with you is curriculum internationalisation. And here's a nice little photo of a group of students on my campus enjoying what Perth is well known for, which is a climate much like yours, I believe. Less humid, however. Okay, so in the keynote that Betty Lesk gave last week, she pointed out a new framework for internationalization of the curriculum. She called it the 4.0 action framework, and she had 10 principles in that. Within that 10 principles, three top ones were, or the three first ones were, that you need to be purposeful, we need to understand complexity, and that what we do around curriculum internationalization needs to be design driven. And that's the focus this morning for me, or evening for you, the idea of design driven. So my objectives for this session really are to turn things around a little bit. So rather than focus on challenges, I'm going to talk to the opportunities that challenges provide us. I'm going to present curriculum internationalization as a change process, which I think is really important when we want to engage our stakeholders, our faculty and professional and administrative staff. And then I'm going to introduce the design methodology for internationalization of the curriculum. So a lot to get in less than 15 minutes now. Okay, so the first opportunity that we have really is understanding that the meaning of internationalization is not clear, and the meaning of internationalization of the curriculum is also not clear. But this is a great opportunity because it means we can start conversations with our stakeholders and work towards some sort of consensus before understanding what we're talking about. And that's a really important part of our process.
Professor Craig, could you share your screen with us?
I am sharing your screen. Oh, sorry.
Thank you very much.
Okay, how's that? Is that okay? Can everyone see that?
Yes, thank you.
All right, so sorry about that. So first opportunity, the meaning of internationalization is not clear. Second opportunity is that there are a lot of underlying assumptions about what internationalization of the curriculum is, and many of these are dated. So what we have is an opportunity to explore new ways of thinking. And again, that comes down to this idea of conversation. And conversations is really an important part of coming to develop something like a curriculum in an international and global context, which we're in today. Professor Fazil Rizvi from the University of Melbourne, when he was talking about internationalization, introduced this idea of the new normals. And as you can see from the list on the left there, things have changed a lot in our world today. So this idea, for example, of hybridization of people and cultures. So my two children are both Japanese and Australian, but they're Gen X, Gen Y, whatever, you know, they're all mixed up. So thinking about students as being A, B, or C is not necessarily the right way to think about the students or the people that we interact with. So it's an opportunity to really critically examine our new realities as we move forward into curriculum design and development. Our next opportunity is to understand that most faculty that we deal with have little or no experience in curriculum design and development. Curriculum, as we understand it, is a very complex notion. It takes in many different ideas and many different kind of perspectives and drives and underlining values. Where our staff are really skilled at is development of a syllabus. But a syllabus is a set of resources designed to inform students about a particular topic, and then we develop a way of assessing how well they've taken that information in. There's a very big difference between curriculum and syllabus. And so what we want to do, what I want to do when I'm engaging with staff, and I work a lot with faculty, is to encourage, as you can see there on the slide, divergent thinking. That is to think differently about what they might normally take for granted. So the structure of learning in and of itself, how can we change that? How can we think about that differently? How can we present that in a way that students can engage with that and then for that to be transformative? So one of the things with internationalization of education, and particularly of the curriculum, is we're really talking about the transformational. And so that's a really important concept to work through with your colleagues, and also then to start thinking about how can we, irrespective of the discipline, engage our students in such a way that it's transformational, that the values that we hope to provide them exposure to become part of their worldview, part of their thinking. So curriculum, now this slide looks pretty busy, I'm fairly sure. And what I want to point to is in the bottom right-hand corner of the slide in red is a conversation, curriculum as complicated conversation that Pinar described. Curriculum, as you can see from the slide, takes in more than just the formal and the informal curriculum. And as Betty talks about, or Betty, Professor Less talks about the hidden curriculum. There's also what we intend, there's the intended curriculum. So what we design and then we give to our students in our classes or through our learning management systems, this is the enacted curriculum. And there can be quite a big difference between what we intend and what we actually do. Then there's the idea of the experience curriculum. So from the student point of view, what they experience might be quite different from what we've enacted and what we've intended. Therefore, evaluation becomes a really important part. So again, conversations with students about what we've learned and what we haven't learned. And the concept that I like, and I'm having conversations with Betty Lesk about, is this idea of curriculum being rhizomatic. So picking up on the points of connectivity, multiplicity, community, and so on. It's important then to think about ways in which we can unsettle and then lead discussions around what do we mean by curriculum. And for me, I believe that it's a narrow definition of internationalization of the curriculum to focus simply on international and intercultural dimensions. It's more than that. We need more than that from an international curriculum in this complicated world in which we live today. All right, so how do we actually internationalize our curriculum? So there are models around, there are other models than Betty's, and what I've got on the right-hand side here is a process model that she developed through the fellowship work that she did. And in our conversations, we thought that it was really important to, first of all, review and reflect on what your current practices are, what your curriculum or your syllabus actually is, and then have difficult and complicated conversations with your members of the teaching team or faculty within whom you work. With that then is the idea of the imagination and to think through how to actually create different ways to be divergent and so on and so forth. On our website, which the URL is down the bottom there for you to have a look at, we explain this in detail. We provide examples from practice here in Australia. And we also have a collection of resources which you might find useful if you want to go there and explore those options. The key point here is that you need to be systematic. We need a systems approach, and you can see the reasons outlined there on the slide as to why. So first of all, when we come to curriculum design development working with faculty, is we've got to understand that we work in a really complex and evolving environmental educational environment, which means that the skill sets that are being asked for of individual academics, individual faculty, are often beyond their training. So for example, learning about learning analytics and thinking about how to use those in the design and development of my curriculum can be quite challenging. So there's a need to start thinking beyond working with individual faculty and start to think more about the design team and thinking about curriculum development as a design process involving a team of people, each with different skills, and that each of those skills are really important. It's also understanding important to understand the organisational landscape and the learning contexts or learning from other contexts. So on this slide here is an example from looking at organisation around sustainability in higher education, which shares many features with internationalisation. And you can see there are lots of considerations and there are a lot of tensions and conflicts or paradoxes. So being able to work through and with and in paradox becomes a really important consideration. Three, understanding that curriculum internationalization is a change phenomena and therefore requires a change process is really important. You can come back to that. Identifying stakeholders, it's really important to get into stakeholder analysis and think about who are the partners, who are the alliances. Like connecting with the library, you wouldn't think is so important, but actually it is really important if you want to internationalize your curriculum or any of the subjects that you offer. So thinking about the many different goals and agendas. So management has quite a different understanding of internationalization. The individual staff has a different, how do you reconcile, how do you bring these together? So it means thinking about faculty and professional staff engagement in different ways. And that one of the really important things in this is that we're all trying to make sense of often what is a messy and complicated environment. So we need to think about different ways of communicating. One message, one type of message is not good enough. What we need to use is this idea of multimodal messaging. So how I communicate to the service staff, how I communicate to faculties, how I communicate to professors, I need to think about different ways of saying the same thing that resonate with them. Reconceptualizing how we think about and present our faculty, for example, you know, like, so the idea of champions or problem solvers or thought leaders, this idea of learning agility, it's a useful concept to think about and also to apply with our students. Okay, so in my context, what we've done is we've taken a design thinking approach to curriculum internationalization. I really like this approach because of the way in which you have to work through, as you can see on the screen there, this idea of understanding, exploring, and then finally the materialization. So getting students to really, or staff in this case, to really think about who is the client, the student, to really think about ways in which to define the problem, which means then a process of ideation, coming up with all these ideas, then this prototyping and testing, and then implementing. So this follows very similar kind of line with action research, and I think it has a lot of utility. So we designed our entire postgraduate certificate. This certificate is for professional learning for teaching excellence. It's intended for faculty at all levels. It comprises four units, and the information is on the left of the screen there. And the first unit, the learning cycle unit, is really about providing that fundamental knowledge that all faculty need to know in order to be able to engage in curriculum design and development. So you can see the topics that we canvass there, the learning curriculum design, assessment, those sorts of things. The next two units in this are really designed to provide staff with an opportunity, or these students, the profession, the academic staff doing this, opportunities to develop an innovation, to put that innovation into practice in their own teaching context, and then to evaluate and then refine that following the design thinking approach. And then finally to present that in the teaching portfolio. The image at the top shows you discovery through understanding, ideation, experimentation, and then evaluation, the process we go through, and the various dimensions coming out of that first unit. And we've modularized this so that as you're working through the various modules, you start by exploring, engaging, and then extending into your own practice. What we're finding from the evaluations we're doing with people who've completed this is they really like the opportunity, because it starts, provided in this postgraduate certificate, because it starts by focusing on their practice. And it's entirely designed around their practice. The assessments involve them doing work in their particular curriculum and then having colleagues provide feedback and helping to redevelop, redesign, tweak what is their particular innovation is. So my time is finished. That was a very quick overview. I do think there's a lot of potential in the design thinking approach, and it's something that I'd really like to explore with you through the centre, and how we can engage with internationalisation of the curriculum through this and other lenses. So thank you very much. I'll stop sharing my screen now.
Thank you very well, Professor Craig. His considerations are excellent, which make us reflect on the education process in the higher education context, and especially in this pandemic context. At this moment, we pass the words to Professor Luciane Slavieri. Dr. Slavieri earned her doctoral PhD at the Modern Language from University del Salvador. She is a specialist in university management from the Inter-American University Organization of Canada, and finished her postdoctoral studies in internationalization and knowledge management at the Universidade Federal de Santa Catarina. She is past president of the Brazilian Association of International Education, and she is currently professor of internationalization of higher education at Universidade Federal de Santa Catarina, Brazil, and also a research at the Institute of Studies and Research in University Administration at the same institution. She also works as a higher education consultancy for the Brazilian Association of Higher Education Sponsors and the U-Experience Consortium, helping higher education institutions with the internationalization process. Please welcome Dr. Luciane.
Good evening, everyone. Good morning to the ones who are in the opposite side of the globe. It's a great honor to be here. I'd like to give my special thanks to Professor Marília Morosini and to compliment for this fabulous initiative of creating the Center Brazil Australia for the internationalization of higher education. We all know that in Latin America, we need a huge support for the internationalization, and we should focus on more initiatives like this. And thank you again, Marília, for inviting me to share this panel with Professor Craig and share my ideas, my experience about internationalization of curriculum. I'd like to share some slides with you as well in order to provide some information about my experience. When I was first designing this presentation, I was thinking that I could just talk about theories and bring some concepts about internationalization of higher education. But instead of doing that, I'd like to share this theory, but also including my personal experience, the practice that I had for the last 5 years teaching internationalization with different universities. Some of you know my curriculum. I worked as the director of internationalization at Universidade de Caxias do Sul in the south of Brazil. It's a private institution. And also, been doing some research about internationalization at a Federal University of Santa Catarina, and also working with cross-cultural studies. So in both institutions, I had a chance to teach cross-cultural studies for different groups of undergraduate students. And each group was about 20 to 30 students. And the most impressive thing, almost 80% of my students were from different parts of the planet, were international students. And that's the experience I'd like to share with you today. So when we mentioned that I was going to talk about the internationalization process. I'm just checking my screen here. Can you see my slides?
Yes, prof.
Okay, I'm sorry. It's just not going on. Okay. When I decided to discuss a little bit about this methodological approach of internationalization of curriculum, I'm giving you my email just in case you want to progress with this discussion. When I was looking for some information, and I'm pretty sure that Professor Craig and Professor Betty Lisk and Professor Wendy Green, they have been updating the definition. And I looked back for the first definition of internationalization of curriculum, and it brought to us that it was an international orientation aimed to prepare students for professionally and socially to act in internationally multicultural context and must be designed for domestic students as well as foreign students. So here we also have the concept of internationalization for all. The idea was exactly to bring this back to 1995 and think that we are in 2020 and the concept of internationalization of curriculum are still sometimes, especially in Latin America, not very clear. And I asked myself following Simon Sinek lectures, why do we need to internationalize the curriculum? How do we do that? And what is the best way to do that? And when I looked for the why do we have to internationalize the curriculum, I'd like to invite you to have this reflections with me, to think about 1998, the UNESCO first designed the model for international cooperation, almost like telling the institutions that we should do it, we should cooperate in order to compete with the best universities in the world. The 17 sustainable goals also designed that we do have lots of interesting things, inclusion, sustainable development, focusing on internationalization. The program for assessment for international students, PISA, is also teaching us that we do have to focus on global competences. We are living in the globalization society and also in the knowledge society. So this is the panorama where we are talking about internationalization of curriculum. Plus, we are in the middle of artificial intelligence, kind of getting closer and closer to our daily lives. We have the industry 4.0, so this is the scenario that we are discussing internationalization. Also, we have the Internet of Things and our students and the population, the professionals with high connectivity. I'm bringing this because this is showing us we must reflect about what were the new professional skills for the 21st century. Thinking about the X, Y, and Z generation, the profile of the millennials, the globals, the global students that we do have, the T-shaped professional, the soft skills are being much more demanded than the hard skills. And this T-shaped professional is supposed to have a broad general knowledge and skills in order to develop his professional abilities, but deep expertise. And this deep expertise means that we are supposed to develop this new technology, especially the soft skills. There was some creation and use of new terminologies, global economy, global environment, global challenges, global engagement, global citizenship, global learning, global competences. So all of these new terminologies are kind of giving basis to our discussions. But sometimes, as Professor Craig mentioned, lots of professors are still not very sure exactly what they have to do in order to develop global competences on their students. What do we have to do in order to internationalize our curriculums? Based on the competences and the skills developed for the next millennium, the students are supposed to have knowledge, values, attitudes, and skills in four great pillars: examine local, global, and intercultural issues. Understand and appreciate the perspectives and worldviews of others. Engage in open, appropriate, and effective interaction across cultures. Take action for collective well-being and sustainable development. So this is easy to understand, but sometimes it's very hard work when you do think about your classroom. When, if you are a professor, when you do have to think about, okay, but how am I going to internationalize my own curriculum? And that happens to me. When I first started teaching cross-cultural studies, my first concern was, okay, I'm going to understand my student profile. I'm going to understand what kind of skills do they need. I'm going to check the learning environment, check the curriculum content, check for campus resources, what could I use, what infrastructure I had. I decided the language of instruction. If I had international students, I would speak English with them because it was the most obvious thing, the global language. I would look for institutional partnerships and, of course, be based on learning assessment. But something, I noted that some things were not going very right with my international students. Remember, I had groups of 30 students regularly enrolled at the university, and 80% were from Germany, China, France, Italy, United States, Senegal, Mozambique, Bahrain. So I had students from all over the world. And I could notice why some students do not participate in the classroom. Are the topics interesting? What should I do to get everybody engaged? Why some of them are so quiet? And I could notice that I had to go deeper into this reflection about internationalizing the curriculum, which is not just to start teaching with a different language. It's not just using English as a medium of instruction or any other language. I noticed that my international classroom was formed with so many different minds, so many different world understandings, so many different expectations, and especially so many different reactions. So I had to reanalyze the student profile, understanding that they have a different cultural background. The student skills were supposed to have this global component. The learning environment was completely internationalized. It was not a regular classroom. Curriculum contents, I had to use global issues in order to bring all my students interested in what we are discussing on that day. Campus resources, I had to focus and use all the resources I had at the campus of both institutions in order to bring them into the classroom and use this potential resource I had. Language of instruction, it was not just an issue of communication, it was much more. It was culture, communication, and knowledge. The international partners, it was not just using institutional partners to develop my discipline. I had to focus on internationalization. And of course, not just learning assessment, but learning outcomes. What was I expecting? In order to develop that, I had to completely understand I needed to change something from student learned, completely professor dependent, to learning autonomy in order to be the owner of its own knowledge. And then I started using the active methodology, the active learning methodologies, which has a concept of critical reflexive education based on the stimulus in the teaching learning process resulting in the involvement by the students in the search of knowledge. So if you understand that we are in the knowledge of society of knowledge, the pedagogy area, what do we have to develop in our students? Stimulate open-mindedness, constant innovation, self-reflection, self-evaluation, use creativity, criticality, and problem-solving capacity in order to develop this disruptive internationalization. Understanding that we have a moment right now, specifically during the pandemic situation, moving from face-to-face internationalization to digital internationalization. Understanding that comprehensive internationalization, internationalization at home, internationalization of curriculum must be disruptive at this moment, but must be responsible as well. Which means that we are supposed to do more, but to do much better. Understand internationalization of curriculum as central part of the student learner. Maximize learning outcomes, no more inputs and outputs. Let's focus on the results of learning. Develop internationalized ecosystems. Use the potential of the internationalization of the campus. Value human capital, retained intellectual capital. Use knowledge management tools in order to internationalize the curriculum. So the disruption is right now. Professora Marília just mentioned, especially at this moment, we have to focus on what are the solutions, what are the problems we're facing, and especially the challenges. I could notice myself, I had two levels of huge challenge to face. The first one was in the classroom. I was not sure about the language competency of my students. I thought all of them could be able to speak English, and some of them could speak English, but their English was not very understandable. We had different cultural references, cultural backgrounds. What's the concept of cleaning? What's the concept of space? The concept of time? The concept of kissing, hugging, or bowing, or shaking hands? Different learning styles. Some students learn very quick, very fast. Some others have different styles of learning. The curriculum, I had a completely monofocused curriculum. The research development, some students were not ready to do research. Institutionally, of course, we had huge barriers, internal structures, faculty pay attention to this observation, this engagement. Professor Craig mentioned, it's not easy to invite professors to design, to completely restructure their curriculum. Due to lack of knowledge of other cultures, lack of knowledge of different educational systems, lack of knowledge of foreign languages. So the biggest change was the focus. And I learned I had to move my focus from curriculum to from my pedagogy. I had to teach not exactly the topics, what I was teaching. The focus exactly, what do we teach? I had to move to much better understanding to how do we teach? Which means provide an academic environment that supports diverse cultural learning needs to a pluralistic, culturally inclusive, respecting diversity. So it was very interesting to understand that the program design, some things that I was doing that were not very good. Less teacher-centered, less individual learning, less student isolation, alienation. I noticed that some of my students were not participating. They were just being isolated. Instead of including them in my classroom, I was excluding. So I changed my perspective, going to a more inclusive student center, listen to everyone, paying more attention to my students, more co-working, more co-production, more co-learning, helping each other to progress with the topics, and especially much more student connections. Which means that I started using active learning methodologies. Just to give you some examples, problem-based learning. What kind of problem do you have in your country about sustainability? And let's share your experience. Let's share the information. Team-based learning. Let's learn together. Let's develop together. Professor is the facilitator for the internationalization of curriculum. We don't have the knowledge. Students will help us to develop the topics to be discussed. Project-based learning, flipped classroom, peer instruction, peer evaluation, design thinking, and any other methodologies that we can develop in order to go back. So internationalization of curriculum, as well as I understand internationalization, it's not a department, it's a behavior. The whole university must look for learning outcomes, which means to understand global awareness, world mindedness, develop the world as a point of reference, non-Eurocentric teaching examples, must be student-centered, and so many other embracing the pluralism that will give us support. What happens now to higher education institutions? I'm provoking you to think about the six P's. People. We need, first of all, people must be convinced. People must begin doing the internationalization of curriculum. Of course, we need the policy, institutional policies to help us to develop the planning. Planning to help us to follow exactly the process of the internationalization of curriculum. With this process, we go to praxis, and the praxis will focus again on the product. So which means that the higher education institutions must be engaged on the internationalization of curriculum. Massive training, teacher training, massive understanding, lots of studies to understand exactly what do we need to go for this internationalization of curriculum. But specifically, I'm bringing you here again, the responsible internationalization. If you talk about internationalization of curriculum in the classroom, it must be in a balanced way, with reciprocity, with equilibrium, with balance of the topics of the global information that we are gonna bring, not in order to bring just European examples, North American examples. Let's look for global examples. Accountability, let's tell the society exactly what we are doing. Let's use the potential of international students in our classroom. Sustainability, how can we give sustainability for this international student classroom, internationalization at home, and right now, digital internationalization. Inclusion, include students to all kinds of activities. Understand that Chinese behave different than German students. They will react different than Brazilian students. And compliance, if we say yes to the internationalization, we are saying yes to the internationalization of curriculum, comprehensive internationalization, and many on. To conclude, I'd like to share these lines with you. Between what I think, what I want to say, what I think I'm saying, and what I say, what you want to hear, what you think you understand, what you want to understand, and what you really understand, there are at least 9 possibilities that we will not understand each other. Imagine if we speak the same language, we do have this possibility. If we don't speak the same language, of course, we are going to face so many other problems. So the idea is student center, focus on the pedagogy, active learning methodologies in order to develop the global competences so needed for this global world. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Luciani. I am Dr. Marilia Morosini. My postdoctoral research was at the University of Texas at Austin. I am A1 research at National Council of Scientific Technological Development. I am a full professor of PUC and the chief editor of the Brazilian Encyclopedia of Higher Education. Okay. Before passing questions to the presenters and after the brilliant lecture, as a mediator, I will make some considerations. The first is that the scientific field for the internationalization of higher education is interdisciplinary and multidimensional. In the first screen, you can summarize this. Please put the first screen. This is the internationalization at home. It can be visualized in the perspective of the scientific field from Bourdieu, reflecting the struggles between positions and agents disputing a symbolic capital, a scientific authority. This nature of the field makes the definition of its limits and disciplinary relations very complex. But what the other screen, please? It is important to say the internationalization of higher education in Latin America context is understood like a cross-border mobility. I usually use the figure of the plane. It was the dream of the plane. But considering the benefits for the quality of higher education courses, the limited possibilities of mobility in face of the economic crisis of the region and the pandemic moment, really, the potential academic and cultural benefits presented by internationalization of the curriculum and the internationalization at home, it becomes imperative to seek new internationalization strategies. The next screen. You made a research with 29 academic staff from PUC, from education, business area, economics, and letters. And they said in 2017, when they were questioned about how much their programs are internationalized, all respondents answered to on a scale of up to 5. The justification for this choice were basic programs do not address internationalization of the curriculum. Internationalization of the curriculum is part of the isolated effort of some professors. And the necessity to learn more about the internationalization process and how to implement this perspective. This survey confirmed the necessity of new possibilities of internationalization that our guest speaker showed us. The next screen. When asked about the greatest need for teachers, they said, problems with the use of English language. To know better the techniques and methods for an international approach. Staff need to be motivated to work in this perspective. One representative said, the key element that needs further work is the understanding of the main concepts regarding the internationalization of the curricular concepts to the students, realities, profiles, and decide which topics of the programs are best suited to be internationalization drive. Now, let's move on the contribution made by our participants in the chat. Let's make a block with some questions that were not addressed by our guest in their representation to enrich the debate on internationalization of higher education and didactic. Craig, please, can you respond this answer? What do you think is the most important challenges and or opportunity to international higher education into the future? And Luciani, how the international of internationalization of the curriculum can benefit from knowledge management to enhance learning outcomes, considering that you are in the digital age? You have more questions. Just a minute, please. Okay. To Craig, in Australia, many universities have internationalized curriculums. What was the main challenge to get to this point, considering institutional and faculty perspectives? Luciane, what is the biggest challenge for internationalization of higher education evolution in Brazil, apart from public policies, which is going to the discussion of the next webinar? Please, can you answer this question, please?
Should I start? Or Professor Craig?
Okay, Michel, you decided. You can answer, please.
Okay, yeah. So you'll start answering. I can read Carla Cassol. Hello, Carla, thank you very much for your question. And you were asking me here, what's the biggest challenge for internationalization of higher education evolution in Brazil? I'm gonna try to be very brief in order to have more participation of people. I understand that we do have two very big challenges. The first one is the academic, and the second one is the institutional challenge. The academic means that our professors are not still convinced about the reasons, about the importance, about the relevant role that internationalization is representing to our students. So we have to develop academic programs, and I would say capacity building programs, in order to develop these skills in the faculty, promoting on them the sense of urge that internationalization is extremely necessary. And not only helping students for the mobility academic programs, not only for internationalization of curriculum, but the whole comprehensive internationalization proposed by Hudzik. So academically, we have to start discussing, we have to start bringing this meetings where we understand the concepts of internationalization, how do we do the practice in the classroom, why do we do that? Institutionally, of course, we have huge challenges as well. The first one, of course, is who pays the bill? Of course, we need support, we need resources for the internationalization. And not only for traveling and visiting institutions, I'm not counting on that. I'm counting on institutional support to design policies, to design programs, to design plans, in order to give some directions for the professors to follow, in order to the whole academy, the whole group of people who deals academically with the management, with the leadership of the institutions, will understand that internationalization, it's not marginal anymore. It's central, and we need to internationalize, not because it's beautiful, not because it's interesting to say that we have people from Australia visiting the campus, because it's in the heart of knowledge. Knowledge is universal. And being universal, we are supposed to exchange these opportunities, exchange this information, transforming into knowledge, into wisdom, and of course, progressing with the whole situation. So two big challenges, academic and institutional. Thank you, Marília.
Thank you. And I think that what you've outlined, those two challenges, are universal across, sorry. I think what you've outlined, the two challenges are universal. Those same challenges exist in the Australian context still. After two decades of considerable work, they still reside. They exist in the American context, they exist in the European context. We're really involved, and that's why I was talking about the transformational. What we're talking about in large ways, and when you're talking about the responsible internationalization, is a set of values and ideals that don't necessarily sit with the same sorts of neoliberal fundamental economic drivers that underpin a lot of what's happening across the sector. So the International Office, for example, might view internationalization really as being a way of creating revenue. And here in Australia at the moment, we're really experiencing some significant challenges because of COVID and the loss of international student revenue to universities. That's having a major impact on operations, and we'll find that, you know, many professors are losing their jobs and things like that because of that reliance on that. So thank you very much, because I think that you highlighted a range of things that I would like to have canvassed as well, but you did it so eloquently. My focus really was on how do you engage staff and how do you get them to think about, when I say staff, I mean professors, how do you get them to think about engaging with curriculum and thinking about what they can do and how they can do that differently. So this idea of disruption, I think, is a wonderful idea. My colleague Wendy Green talks about unsettling, and that's perhaps a less harsh way of dealing it with our colleagues. You know, we want to unsettle them, make them feel uncomfortable about what they're doing, and then move forward with that. I think in answer to the first question about the challenges for the future, you've outlined a lot of those. Listen, what we are really having to come to terms with today and tomorrow is that we're not living in unprecedented times. I mean, there's lots of change going on in the world. Who could have imagined the Trump universe the way that's playing out and the effects that's having globally? We're living in really perilous times. And that's why I think that it's really important to think much more broadly about the idea of international education. And so the notion of the responsible internationalization resonates really, really well. And I've drawn a lot on the work of Martin Buber and his dialogic philosophy about how we look at and interact with each other. And so I really want to point to the relational and thinking about how can we create environments that help students to see themselves and others in this kind of relational dialogic kind of process, where you're not looking at the other as an object, but as an essential person, essentially. So really, it's about designing, for me, the big challenge is designing ways to interact with professors that encourage them to think differently about the curriculum, and that the curriculum is a much broader concept than simply syllabus, right? And yeah. So, yes, the focus on learning outcomes is really, really important. And when we engage with the design thinking process, we're also using constructive alignment and backward planning for that. So that starts with what is the learning outcome? What is it that we actually want to engender our students with, other than just knowledge and skills? Knowledge and skills is important, but there's values there as well. What type of person do we want our students to become? So there's the ontological dimension to that. And it starts with the learning outcome. So having those challenging and difficult conversations, going back to my slide. So the second question I'll address is around the Australian context and internationalization in the Australian context. What was the main challenge to get to this point? Exact same challenges. So same two challenges, the academic and the institutional. And oftentimes they're not necessarily in sync together. They are sometimes quite divergent in terms of goals, rationales, objectives, and implementation. What we had in Australia, which was absolutely fundamental, I think, to really promoting international education, was government support. Our governments, over the period of a couple of, or over a decade, developed an office for learning and teaching. That office provided funding for research into higher education pedagogy, the higher education learning landscape, and they had themes. One of the themes was international education. And so they provided professors across all Australian universities an opportunity to explore and promote. It was very practice orientated. So in terms of, they would fund you to do some research, but you had to develop a series of resources that you would give back to the community, and those resources then would be used across the country by professors and academic support people, developers, those sorts of things. So I think having, first of all, government support is really important. This is very challenging in an environment where we want to, or governments tend to want to look more inward as opposed to outward and think about those connections. And then institutional, the second thing that you really, really need is top-down support. If you don't have the president of your university supporting your endeavor, it becomes very, very difficult to maintain and sustain over time. So what we've witnessed here in Australia is we've had university presidents and vice chancellors and leadership teams support internationalization as being a really important dimension to their institution. But over time, priorities have changed. So the focus now, for example, is on online learning, for example, and providing support and development in that particular area, which is needed. However, that means then that the resources once given to internationalization, no longer there. So then it's thinking creatively about how you can work in that new environment to maintain that same goal. So again, thinking much more broadly about international education in terms of what that comprises and how you go forward with that. So yes, those two challenges, the academic, the institutional, and also then the government. And my final thing is that what we really need to do is think about this kind of engagement as a form of PR, promotion. It's really important that we have conversations and we keep talking about internationalization through different lenses and highlight the strengths and values of that for social cohesion and society more broadly as we move into the future. Thank you.
Okay, you have received many other questions, but it's impossible to answer now. But to end, this was our first webinar. And I would like to thank on behalf of the International Center of Brazil Australia, each of our guests for the theoretical and practical contribution they have made, for each one's contribution to the field of internationalization of higher education and the consolidation Brazil PUC and Australia, a network, and also to each one of our participants. Then, I will be another thematic webinar about public policies for the internationalization of education. It will feature the following guests: Matthew Johnston, Counselor of the Education and Science at the Australia Embassy, Dr. Connie McMuse from Universidade de Brasília, and Dr. Alexandre Guilherme from PUC. You can get access to it by clicking on the link provided in the chat function. For now, thank you for your presence. I hope to connect in person or virtually with you soon as the center. Have a nice time. Stay safe and healthy. Goodbye. Thank you.